man. Yeah. Now we got it.
Yeah, how's that?
Hey, I'm fine. I'm fine. Yeah, this is great times now for me in my life.
Yeah.
I feel very fulfilled. I feel very fulfilled. Yeah. Because, you know, I've been on this journey for about 5 decades now.
Mm-hmm.
So it's great times for me because my reality is unfolding.
Yes.
It's unfolding. Yes. So I'm a happy man.
Yes.
I'm a happy man. I feel fulfilled. I feel contented. Yeah. So that's how to answer your question, man.
Yeah. So the first question I would like to start with is, what was growing in Nigeria like?
Growing in Nigeria, beautiful. Mm. Because I believe, you know, we are born on earth to come in here for a purpose. So, yeah, I was born here. I was born into this place. And this is my reality. This is my own constituency. So I'm not going to run away from Nigeria. You understand? I'm not going to japa. That's what the young people say, japa. You know, everybody wants to jump to Canada, jump to America, jump to any Babylon. I'm not doing that.
Right,
so I've stayed put. I'm here to contribute my own quota. And that's what I'm doing. Yes.
That's right. Did you get started in art?
I was born into art.
Yes.
Art was within me. You know, I became conscious, like, around the age of 6.
Yes.
I became conscious of my talent. I used to draw on the sand in the ground with a broomstick. That's how I started. And then during my school days, sometimes, you know, I'll be in mathematics class. And, you know, I'll be drawing the teacher. So I get into trouble. My dad, my papa wanted me to be an engineer. But, you know, art wasn't me. So eventually, you know, I found my direction. So I actually self-taught, you know, like an autodidact. I trained myself by sight, by asking questions, by checking out exhibitions and looking at what people do. And I go and practice and test myself on it. So that's how I started. That was my grounding.
Yes. So, like, anytime you pick a paintbrush, like, and, you know, start designing, like, what kind of feeling do you get?
I feel euphoric.
Yes.
Because it's within, it's in my blood, it's in my bone marrow. You know, that duty. This is my own duty on earth. So, to express myself visually, you know, and graphically, and, you know, to speak my mind with, you know, what I can do with my hands. So I always feel very happy. I'm a bit reclusive, even though I service the entertainment industry for 47 years now. I don't socialize too much. I love my own company. My own company to me is my best friend. So I love to work. I'm a workaholic. I just like to draw or, you know, whatever. And those are some of the things that I picked up from Fela Kuti, my association with Fela Kuti. You know, he was a workaholic. He loved to compose music every time with all the fight against the system, with all the police brutality he was going through. He was composing, and I was watching him. I met Fela Kuti when I was 18. So that opened my eyes to a lot of things in this life. He showed me how to be resolute. He showed me how to be confident of what I have. He showed me how to express myself. Fela was my mentor. He was my teacher. And we studied metaphysics together. So he was my master in metaphysics. I was the acolyte.
Yes.
And then, you know, we had a very robust relationship. So all that, you know, gathered with what I came with. we just make do the best that we can.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, like I was saying, life is a journey. Life is a journey. We have to make up our minds who we are. So the first key point in life is to know thyself. Know thyself. You have to know who you are, so you know who you are meant to be and the role you are supposed to play. So from knowing thyself, you know the inkling that you have, the passion that you have, that is your talent. Then you learn how to hone the skill that you have, develop the talent. So that's the tool, that's the weapon that the universe gives to each human being to come upon earth, you know. So a lot of us get here, we get misdirected by society, a lot of false teachings, a lot of miseducation, misdirection by society, and sometimes by the parents.
Yeah, you know, like this is like the story of life itself, you know. So life sometimes, you know, kick you around,
yes.
You know. It goes like a pendulum swinging high and low. So you have to take the highs with the low.
Sure.
That's the reality. Yeah, no life is perfect. You know, it's high and low. So, correct. Yeah, let's go on. Let's go on, man. Let's go on.
Yes. Yeah, so, like, how did you end up meeting Fela Kuti? And how did you end up doing his artwork?
Destiny. I use one word. The word is predestination. Predestination. Because we're all here with a destiny. And we need to find our destiny and our sense of purpose. In 1974 specifically, two things happened that decided my destiny for me. One, I was doing portraits for people in my neighborhood at that point in time. And someone commissioned me, rather than to do his portrait, he wanted me to do the poster painting of Bruce Lee's film, Enter the Dragon. So I did the poster of Bruce Lee's film, Enter the Dragon, for the guy. You know, the film was major. It had three main actors, Bruce Lee, John Saxon, and Jim Kelly. So that's item one that was leading me to my destiny. Item two, Fela released an album called Music of Fela, Ruffa Ruffa Fight.
Mm-hmm.
So I had given myself assignment, like, throughout the year. My own kind of New Year resolution for 1974 was I was going to do a drawing a day throughout the year. So I used to play that fella's album, Ruffa Ruffa Fight. And one morning, I was looking for material to paint that particular day. And my spirit said to me, why don't I do a version of the album cover of that fella's album? So as for my practice, so I created my own album cover for Ruffa Ruffa Fight. And now there was a journalist with a newspaper called The Punch, Sunday Punch in Nigeria. He went to drink in the drink place where I did that Bruce Lee poster for the guy. And he saw the Bruce Lee poster. So he asked, who did this? And the guy said, it's a small boy next door. And the journalist was really intrigued. Like, the work was good enough, and he was surprised. A small boy, he said he wanted to see the small boy. So they brought him to see me. He wanted to see my portfolio. And I brought out, you know, a couple of drawings, dozens of drawings that I've made for that year. And he saw the Fela album cover, the one that I did for my own practice. And he said, can you do album covers? I was a bit shy, you know, mm-hmm. but I had done two covers before. I did one for my uncle. It was never published. That's 48 years now. I still have it. I still have that original. I kept it. And then I did one for a musician who I met at the TV station. That was my first to be published. So when the journalist, Babatunde Harrison, asked if I could do album covers, I answered in the affirmative, but, you know, in a very shy way. And he said to me, 2 days before that day, he and Fela were discussing about, you know, covers. You know, like cover art. And I looked at him, I didn't believe him. I said, this uncle is drunk because he's coming from the drink place. You know, I didn't have any ambition. You know, I didn't imagine, you know, I wasn't fancying of Fela, like, you know, I wanted to meet him or something, but I love his music. I knew about him already. So long story short, the journalist said he was going to give me a test. He would bring a Fela picture for me to do a portrait of Fela as my test. So the next day he brought the picture. I did the portrait. He loved it so much. Within 24 hours. And he said he was taking me to Fela. Just like a dream.
Mm.
And he took me. He got a cab. Took me to Fela's place, Kalakuta. And Fela saw the portrait. When Fela saw the portrait, he said two words. It was the first time in my life I had this word. He said, wow, God damn it. and that was the foundation and the beginning of our friendship and my connecting to my destiny. And I now realize, you know, my destiny was intertwined with Fela's destiny.
Yes.
So that's how we forge that kindred spirit from the beginning.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So, because I must say, he had the revolutionary mindset, you know, he had a very revolutionary mindset. So could you tell us about the kind of person he was?
Fela, like Yoruba people will say, okore meta. That's three men in one. Three men, three man gang. Yeah. You know, he was a very complex human being.
Yes.
He was, we start with radical, rebel, revolutionary, egalitarian, humanist, woman, humanizer, political maverick, musical genius, you know, everything all rolled into one. And he was very brave, very bold, very, very brave, and very committed. He was a very determined fellow, fearless, so to speak. Very fearless. Very fearless. The only person I relate Fela with, like I feel both of them belong to the same category for me, is Peter Tosh. Peter Tosh in Jamaica.
Yes.
Yeah, I met Peter Tosh twice. He has the same spirit with Fela. I love Peter like I love Fela.
Yes.
That's it. Yeah. That's it, man.
Yes, King. So like did he have an input like in your artworks, your artworks that you were doing?
Yeah, like I love to say, in the beginning was the music.
Yes.
The music became so powerful, it needed an accompaniment. And my art came to play the role. So Fela's music was always the foundation of the inspiration, you know, behind all those my cover acts. You know, for his career. So his music, the lyricism, and the greatest thing is I shared the Pan-African ideology with Fela totally, 110%. So I was able to relate to him very effectively because I was prepared for that role. I had been race conscious, you know, I've been race pride conscious since I was before my teenage years. I remember in 1966, I was 11 years old. I fell in love with music of Millicent Small, you know, the British Jamaican lady. I love her music so much. And she came to Nigeria on a promotional tour. I saw her for the first time. I actually thought she was a white lady.
Mm-hmm.
When I saw her black, I was so proud. I said to my aunt, I said, oh, she's a black person. That's how deep my consciousness had been. And when Miriam Makeba left South Africa to live in the US in exile, I was conscious. There was a Miriam Makeba interview in 1969. I was 14. I watched on black and white TV, and it left a lasting memory to me. In 1972, I knew about the Black Panther movement.
Yes,
I knew when
George
Jackson, the Minister of Information for the Black Panther, was incarcerated in San Quentin prison in Los Angeles. And when he was shot dead, you know, shot from behind by a racist prison guard, I knew about it. I read about it in Drum magazine and I cried.
Mm.
I cried.
That was in 71 at that time.
71, yes.
Yeah.
71, good. Yes. Yeah, good. So I did a near-perfect drawing of him as my hero, George Jackson. I still have his book called Blood in My Eyes.
I've read that.
I knew about Stokely Carmichael, Eddie Cleaver.
Yes.
Angela. Oh, thank you. I have a portrait of Angela Davis. Okay, I sent it to you, right?
Yeah.
So I've been involved in all that movement. So by the time I'm connected with Fela, it was fait accompli, like the French would say. It was easy. It was like second nature for me. And that's why I worked with Fela very effectively, because Fela wasn't an easy person as a human being. Fela was very complex, very complicated. And Fela never suffered fools gladly at all. He never suffered fools gladly. So for you to really resonate with Fela, you have to be strong. But Fela was very smart, very clever. He recognized great talent. So the moment he saw my talent, you know, he co-opted me into Kalakuta.
Mm-hmm.
And we worked together effectively. So eventually, you know, we say it's a divine collaboration. It was a collaboration made from the universe, made from heaven. So that's the connection. That's yes. The beauty of it. It was so powerful.
Yes. So, you know, when you met him, like, what kind of conversations were you having with him? Because I was watching this documentary on him. I was watching this documentary and you were like, you read some books, this book called, I forgot the name of it.
Black Man of the Nile, yes, and His, yes, Family by, yes, Professor Yusuf Benjukanan. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. You know what? The moment I became connected to Fela, one of the first things I noticed, he loved to read. He loved to read. He loved knowledge. And the same thing with me. And yes, we studied metaphysics together. We studied the books of Tuesday of Sarampa. He was a Tibetan monk, Buddhist monk. He wrote books on metaphysics and all that. He wrote 19 books. Fela and I, you know, studied all those books. One of the first things, Fela realized, I love to read books. You know, initially in school, I was reading James Halley Chase and all that. So the moment we connected, one day Fela showed me a book by Tuesday of Sarampa. The title was The Third Eye. He showed me, said, Lemi, have you read this? I said, yes, I've read it. I've read Cave of the Ancients. I've read Wisdom of the Ancients. I've read The Hermit. And Fela just went crazy, like, whoa. Then he started exposing me and my friends to books, you know, Pan-African books. Kwame Nkrumah, the first president of Ghana, wrote many books, over 20 books. Fela exposed all that to me and my friends who read. Then coincides African history that I never taught in schools, you understand, in Africa. Because the colonialists, you know, they set up this miseducation system that has been on for centuries, that has made Africans grow up and feel inferior and feel like some bumbleclot, rat clot, you know, inferior beings. Because they teach, like here they teach, they taught us Mungo Park Discover River Niger. Can you imagine?
That's right.
Mungo Park. Whereas when it came, you know, the villagers, the river men showed him around. And they teach us in school that he discovered River Niger. And then they tell us, Mary Slessor stopped the killing of twins in Calabar.
Yeah.
So we have to be worshipping Mary Slessor. Whereas in England, in Europe, they were killing witches on the stage. They burn witches on the road. In England.
Right.
You understand?
Mm.
So, but they never taught us that. Then they brought religion, Christianity, is a white bumble clad angel.
Right.
You understand?
Sure.
And the God is white. The Christ is so blue eye, blonde hair.
And yeah, white Jesus.
The only black figure in the Bible is Satan.
Mm-hmm.
That is us black people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Fela showed us books like Stolen Legacy by George G.M. James.
Mm.
That book revealed that Greek philosophy was stolen from Egypt, the original Egypt, where people like me and you, pure,
yes,
and simple.
Yes,
you know, because the Hyksos Arabs, you know, enslaved Egyptians, crossbreeding has produced present-day Egypt. So, you understand? Look at the pyramids. See, tomorrow, scientists cannot even figure out how those pyramids were built. So, that's how great Africa has been. And there were books like Africa, the Wonder of Western Civilization, and that Black Man of the Nile, and so many other books. And we started reading, we started getting exposed to that. And that's why I created my own names. I changed my names. I used to be Emmanuel Sunday in school. Yes, slave names. So in 1975, Fela said, how can he be bearing Ransom Kuti? Ransom was a slave name. You remember Muhammad Ali from Kachok Lee?
Yeah.
I remember, Malcolm X. So Fela created a name for himself, Anikulapo, to replace Ransom from his family name. So I followed suit. I went to the High Court in Lagos. I made a change of name. So I gave myself Lemi and my grandfather's name, Ghariokwu. So I picked that up. And today, the whole family has changed to that name because I made the name, you know, solid, you know, as a legacy for my family. So that's going. That's it. That's how they build up it. So it was Fela that advised that I concentrate on designing album covers as a career. Yeah, there was nobody that I saw as an example who made a professional top designer album cover. So even till today in Nigeria, it's like I'm the only professional sleeve designer. Mm-hmm. I made it full time work. In the last 47 years, I've designed over 2,000 album covers. That's good, more than good enough for the Guinness Book of Records. And then look at my collaboration with Fela Kuti. I designed a body of 26 album covers for Fela's career, spanning 3 decades, from 1974 to 1992, 70s, 80s, and early 90s. Yes. You know that. So that's my call to fame today. And I've designed covers for over hundreds of artists across the globe. So yeah, so I'm a happy man.
Yes, definitely, definitely. So like, you were just talking about, you know, us reading our history, because reading is what, you know, during slavery, the slave master hid this away from us during slavery.
Yeah.
So like,
yeah. Please don't call them slave masters. They are not our masters. They are slavers.
That's right.
Yeah, they are slavers. Yeah, Babylon.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, so like, you know, like here in the West, like in the institutions, they ain't gonna teach you about who you are. They ain't gonna teach us about our hidden history, because anytime you get to, maybe let's say on October, like here in the UK, the only month we're allowed to read, like October is the only month where we are allowed to, you know, learn about our history. So what do you think is the solution out of all of this? Because I must say, like, loads of black people living in the West, loads of us have a colonized mindset and all that. So like, what do you think is the solution for the black people or Africans scattered abroad?
Yeah, I wanted to point out it's not only so-called black people living in the West. I say so-called because I'm not a black man, I'm an African.
Yes.
Go and listen
yes.
to Peter Tosh's song African. No matter where you come from, no matter your complexion, as long as you're a black man, you're an African. So I don't agree with my brothers and cousins in America when they call themselves black Americans.
Why should
our race be noted by color? That color, black and white, is a misnomer to make us feel inferior. They tell us black is evil, white is purity. I'm not a black man. We are not supposed to be black people. They don't call Chinese yellow Americans. They don't call Indians red Americans. So why should we be called black Americans? Africans in America, Africans in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
You understand? African anywhere. Yeah, and listen to Fela's song, Center of the World. Center of the World. Yeah, he said, you know, Africans in Caribbeans, Africa in America, that is who they are. You understand? So the colonialism has pervaded everywhere, and we need to come together.
Yes.
We need to come together. Divide and rule is a method that has been used for over 500 years plus. Physical slavery started in 1503.
Yes.
This is 2021. That's 518 years. That's bumbo class, rascal too long.
That's right.
You understand? We need to be woke by now. So we need to come together. We need to learn our history.
Yes.
Self-motivation is very important. Knowledge is very important. They tell you knowledge is power. I say knowledge applied is powerful.
Yes.
All the bumbo class knowledge our people go get in all those institutions, we can't produce nothing.
Yeah.
Africa doesn't produce nothing. In Nigeria, we still import toothpicks. And, you know, thousands upon thousands of graduates from those, you know, educational institutions, they don't produce nothing.
True.
You understand? So where is the knowledge going to be? Power. You get.
That's right.
So self-knowledge, we need to re-educate ourselves. We need to come together as African people everywhere in the world, everywhere. We need to connect. Look at the Jews. Look at the Indians. The Pakistani. Look at the Chinese. The Japanese. Look at the Koreans. So what is wrong with us? What is wrong with us, my brother? We need to be woke by now. So that's why I love what you are doing. You know, you're a young man, but you started good.
Yes.
I started when I was 18.
Yes. Yes.
And I'm growing strong and strong and strong every day.
Yes.
Till my time upon earth run out, I will lay a solid foundation for those who want to learn, to be able to learn something. Fela has done his bit. He's gone I'm carrying on. You have to pass the baton. Yes, the legacy has to go on for generations upon generations to come. Each one teach you on the right thing. We need to do the right thing. Because a lot of musicality that is going on from America, from our brethren, hip-hop and all this, most of the message, the concept of the lyrics is very wrong. It's very wrong. It's very misleading. It's only our race that call their women hoes and bitches. That is wrong. The Chinese cannot call their women hoes or bitches. Yeah. Indians cannot do that. They are conscious of their culture. Yes. So we need to wake up and we call ourselves niggas. That is totally wrong. That's totally wrong. I'm saying this with all sense of responsibility. We need to wake up. We need to use the correct language for ourselves because words are powerful. Words are very powerful. Don't call yourself niggas. Why?
Yeah.
What kind of madness and stupidity and ignorance that can be? That's bumbleclara splat, like Peter Fosh would say. You understand?
Yeah.
Yeah, so only our race does that to each other.
Because the thing is, like, we as black people, like, not even black people, we as African people.
Africans, thank you. Abroad, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Lord, like, anytime we fight against our fellow people, we make the oppressor happy when we fight against each other. That's one thing because, and also, loads of black people. Nah, see,
yeah, I know. You get it right, man. It's a conscious thing. I don't use black. No, I'm not a black man. Yeah, yes. My brothers and sisters are not black people. We are Africans.
Yes, kid. Yeah,
it's important to identify.
Yeah. So the next question I would like to ask is, you've won many awards for your art, including the Nigerian Music Awards for your album cover artwork. So could you tell us about some of your other projects you've done?
I don't know where your question is coming from though, but you know, I just love to do my work. I just love to do my work. All those accolades don't touch me. I'm not doing work for accolades because a lot of times those things are just misdirected.
True.
So I'm not really interested in that. But, you know, people call me King of Covers. That was bestowed on me in the UK in 2004. The Guardian UK labeled me as King of Covers. And the BBC, I went to BBC South. I did an interview and they said, you know, for all sleep designers in the world, you know, that this guy, Lemi Ghariokwu, takes the cake. Because, for example, look at the movement. The movement between my work and Fela Kuti's work. Afrobeat music is known as a package globally. When they talk about the music, in my only two corner, they mention the art, the role the art has played, you know, to brand the music. It's so powerful. There is no musical form that has that kind of collaboration to that extent where I've designed 26 album covers, you know, for that movement. So I created that template. Anybody that has designed any Fela cover after me, follow that template.
Yes.
You understand? So yes. I'm just happy to play my role. I'm happy to contribute that. So forget the accolades. Like Peter Kosh once said, he said, credit is grave and coffin, man.
Yes.
You know, I met Peter twice.
Yeah.
I will exchange kindred spirit.
Yes.
Yeah, fire. Yeah, fire. Yeah, fire bomb Babylon.
In
the
80s. 80s.
No, in the 80s. Yeah. 1982 and 1985. He was visiting in Lagos. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, then. So, like, you know, we had loads of artists during the 70s. We had loads of artists coming from the Caribbeans, like people like Ross Hartman. We had people, you know, I mean, we had loads of people in the 70s, you know, bringing the arts and all that. So, like, could you name some of your favorite artists? Could you name some of your favorite, like, your favorite artists?
You mean musical or visual?
Visual.
Visual artists?
Yes.
That's one interesting or corny thing about me. I never really followed artists, visual artists. I knew about musicians. I just followed music. You know, I probably would have been a musician if not for the art spirit. So I wasn't a fan of visual artists as such. But the kind of things that made impact on me before I even started my work as a cover artist. I remember in 1971 or 72, I saw the album cover of Osibisa, the album titled War Ya Ya.
Yeah.
It had this flying elephant painted on the cover. It was done by Roger Dean. Yeah. And I read up on Roger Dean. I was still in school. I didn't know I was going to be designing covers. I love the work of Roger Dean, you know, at that point in time. But it never showed any influence in my work. I never did any work that is reminiscent of that. Then there was the covers of James Brown, Bootsy Collins, Parliament. You know, I just love those covers. But I wasn't aware of who the artist was until in the year 2003. Yeah. Imagine, from the 70s, I never knew who the artist was. But I was in New York in 2003, and somebody said, oh, my work is a bit similar to Pedro Bell. I said, who is Pedro Bell? And he showed me, he mentioned the art. Oh, I know that art. But, you know, so I wasn't really following artists. But by this time now, I know of Marty, he did covers for Carlos Santana, or, you know, and all that. Very kind of surreal cover art. You know, I didn't, then in Jamaica, because I'm a reggae person, I love reggae so much. I'm a Rastaman at heart. Yes. So I followed reggae from inception. I knew from the onset of the original Wailers from 1973. Yeah, yeah. I still have the Catch a Fire album. I mean, the original Wailers, the Wailers. Yeah. You know, so I know the works of Tony Wright as a cover designer. I love his work. Lemi Ghariokwu. Yeah, you know, Lemi Ghariokwu did a couple of covers for Bob Marley, musicians generally. I love a lot of reggae artists, but Peter Tosh is my most favorite because of what he stood for. Because I see him like Fela.
Yeah.
You know, when he released the album Legalize It, Peter came out and he got beaten by police, just like Fela in Nigeria. I love Peter like that. I love Mucha Baruka. Mucha Baruka, I met him in New York. But you know, Mucha doesn't put on shoes. Even in winter in New York, I saw him. He didn't have shoes on his feet. You know, I love Lynton Kwesi Johnson.
Yeah.
Lynton Kwesi Johnson.
England.
Yeah, from England. So, you know, I just love the reggae movement. And I took a lot from that because I was always studying, you know, the packaging, the branding, the way Bob Marley was made into a huge product. You know, Bob Marley was marketed by a very conscious, big organization, big setup. British government was involved in the project for Bob Marley, you know, to be made into such a huge fellow. He was so talented and everything worked with, you know, a lot of calculation with Chris Blackwell, Island Records and all that. I followed all the process, you know, when Bob Marley's first biography was published. You know, when the album Live in the Adelicion was released and they had free poster, you know, pull out poster that you paste in your room, that's marketing. That was the way rock music was marketed. Because I knew about David Bowie, Mac Bolan, Gary Glitter, Jimmy, you know, even the Beatles, Jimi Hendrix. You understand? So, you know, I've always followed music movements. I didn't follow art movement like that, so I know musicians. I know music a lot. But, you know, it's my role because I came to help brand music. I came to support music. But, you know, I love the revolutionaries because our society needs consciousness. Our society needs powerful message. You understand?
Yeah.
So that's why I love reggae music so much. I'm not talking about slackness, please. No slackness.
Yes.
No slackness. Yeah, I love the roots reggae mostly, you know?
Yeah.
So that's the thing. Yeah. That's the thing.
Yes. So could you name like your top five reggae albums of all time, like your favorite? Okay, it doesn't need to like be your
Oh,
favorite, but you know, like could you name like some of some of your top five?
whoa, that's I never had this question before. This is tricky. But as you're just talking, flash in my mind, Max Romeo, War in a Babylon. In a Babylon. Peter Tosh, Mama Africa. Bob Marley, Bob Marley Uprising, Bonnie Wheeler, Black Heart Man.
Man. Yes.
Then let me put Lynton Kwesi Johnson. Let me just put it like that. Even though Big Youth, U-Roy, I-Roy, Dillinger, so many. But let me just put it that way.
Do you have a favorite artwork of yours? Like, do you have a favorite one?
It's difficult. It's like you have a couple of children and you're asking for favorite, but I always have a way to answer the question. I don't have one favorite. I have a couple of favorites. So like my Fela covers, definitely. I have a couple of them. There's Beast of No Nation. There's Yellow Fever. There is Sorrow, Tears and Blood. There is Zombie. A couple of like that. Then I've done covers for other artists too, like the reggae acts in Nigeria. I love the Mandators. The Mandators, Crisis. I love like covers I've done internationally. I did one this year that I really love, Afrolicious Band. I love the cover art, Then I did a cover for one of the young stars in Nigeria called Fouls the Bad Guy. I did night cover for him in 2019. I love Moral Instruction. A lot. It's not just one single one.
Okay, so like in that way, where does the inspiration come from?
The inspiration is from everyday movement of people around me, the universe, the world itself at large, the politics and the politics and the culture and the lack of it. All that serves as inspiration. And any creative is supposed to be inspired by their immediate environment. It's a natural phenomenon. But in Africa, because of miseducation, a lot of young people want to be Americans. You
Yes,
understand?
true. That's
They
true.
want to be British people, and that's not our culture, really. We can learn and borrow from other cultures. The world is becoming a global village, but we have to have our roots strong in our culture and our tradition. It's very important. So any creative that is aping other cultures in their own environment, I think it's not right. It's like how we dress. Like Fela had this song called Gentleman. I know be gentleman. In Africa, in the hot baking sun, you are dressed in three-piece suit. Can you imagine? And you are sweating like a goat. So can you picture someone in New York in winter dressed like me? No, you should go to the asylum. You understand? So that's the complexity of how our mind has been. The European Babylonian mind fuck that we've gone through for 500 odd years. It's about time we be conscious. So my inspiration is coming every day from around me.
So Africa is rapidly changing, and some say going through another scramble for Africa. So does art have a role to play in creating a more socially conscious, stable, united continent?
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Because art itself is philosophy. Any society that is worth its salt has to listen to its philosophers.
It's true.
The philosophers have a great role to play. You understand? The politics stars, the politicians, mess up society every time. It's the same thing everywhere in the world. The same thing. No place is even more advanced. Human beings have not been advancing in recent memory. Human beings behave more beastly than even the animals in the jungle. Even though human beings advance technologically, they are not advancing mentally. Look at what's happening in Afghanistan. It happened 20 years ago.
Yes.
You know, it's a vicious circle. You understand? So, yeah. Society needs philosophers. Yeah. So art or any kind of form of creative has a major role to play, especially when it's conscious, when it has a message, when it has, you know, a positive message. That is the potential.
Yes.
For
yes.
progress. Yeah.
So really, I've noticed, you know, your artwork really reflects on Pan-Africanism, you know, the arts that you've done. Since, you know, the early 70s to right, like, to this day. So, like, what advice would you give to young fans who are pursuing art as a livelihood?
First advice, know thyself.
Yes.
So you know yourself, you know your calling, you know the role you're supposed to play. Yeah. So you know your commitment, and you make up your mind and pursue that without fear or favor. So you have to be yourself, because each one is very, very unique in their own way. So no one is superior, no one is inferior, and no one is equal either, because we are all unique in our own ways. So the moment you know you are unique, find your uniqueness and pursue it. Like me, I'm in my lane. There's no traffic. I'm in my own lane. So there's no traffic. Yeah. Yes. So that's the way to think.
Yes. Okay, then, yeah. Okay. So, yeah, thank you very much for having this great reasoning with me and all of the people that joined, all of you that joined. Thank you very much for tuning into this reasoning. And also, like, before we mash up the live, what do you say to your fans who, you know, watches you, and you know, the fans that you've got watching?
I'll just say, you know, love is my religion. Love is my religion. I don't go to church. I don't go to mosque. I don't go to shrine. Love is my religion. I don't go to pagoda. I don't go to the Taj Mahal or anywhere. You understand? I don't go to the minaret either. So love is my religion. And let's love one another. Do unto others as you love others to do unto you. That's the greatest law of the universe. If we can practice that, you know, the world will be much better place. It will be much peaceful place. It will be much blissful, because freedom is supposed to be peace, and liberation is supposed to be bliss. So that's what we should aim for.
Okay, then. Yes, that's right. Okay, then. Yeah, thank you very much for this reasoning. Have a very blessed day. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, my brother. Thank you, Freddie. One love always.